Welcome to Real Estate Radio Live, an informative and engaging podcast discussing everything you need to know about the world of real estate. Your host, Joe Cacera, provides you with insight and guidance on how to buy, sell, finance, and invest in real estate. He also offers real estate tax management strategies, new construction advice, home improvement tips, and much, much more. And now, to guide you around the world of real estate, here's your host and Real Estate Radio Live team leader, Joe Cacera.
Welcome to Real Estate Radio Live. No, this is not Joe Cacera. Joe's taking a day off, so he invited me to take over the show for him. My name is Jack Russo. I'm the managing partner at Computer Law Group, LLP, which is a law firm in Palo Alto, California. We help young, growing entrepreneurs and teams build their companies and build their businesses. And we've been doing a series, which Joe has moderated, which started last year with the heading, essentially, Starting Something in Silicon Valley. And now we're building this year a new series that we have talked about in terms of growing your business in Silicon Valley and beyond. And we've been doing a number of discussions which have to do with what do you do step by step in trying to go from a single idea to something that actually becomes a real business. So with that in mind, with last week, we did a topic of know your company's customers and your potential customers. And this week, the goal was to figure out, well, where do you go in actually building a company culture? And I thought there wouldn't be a better way to do this than bring in one of our young future lawyers, who's you're hoping to be a future lawyer, the young paralegal who works for the firm, who came out of college, and I'm going to interview him and talk about what he's experienced in working with our firm at Computer Law Group, with the view of enabling listeners to understand how eventually every firm has to grow over time, and key to that growth is finding excellent people, bringing them in, training them, getting them to understand what you do, what your customers expect you to do in the law firm context, what the clients expect, and then how to operate within the rules and regulations of the profession or the business. So with that, I'll introduce Ian Buckman. Ian, why don't you tell the folks a little bit about yourself?
Hey, so my name is Ian Buckman. I've been working for Jack at Computer Law Group. Monday, it'll be 6 months, so around 6 months.
Congratulations.
Thank you. Yeah, thanks for hiring me. And yeah, so I, as a paralegal, I do basically whatever the lawyers ask me to do. The great thing about working at a small firm is that it really is a variety of stuff. Like, I know people who work at, like, the Perkin Coies or Fenwick and Wests of the world, big law firms, you know, with big prestigious names, and they get to say that they work for firms like that, but what they do is they sit at a desk and they fill out forms all day, or they send out emails. So the really great thing is that I've been getting a variety of work, which is something which really, like, you can't put a price tag on that kind of experience. It's just, it's great stuff.
What we like to say is we want to train the lawyers of the future. Law firms have different models. I, of course, worked at Davis, Stafford, Kelman, and Fenwick that became Fenwick & West. It's a pretty big firm. When I was there, it was just a handful of people. Now I think they're up to 400 or 500 lawyers. Great firm. Lots of friends there. Lots of colleagues. They often refer clients and opportunities to us all the time. But the culture is quite different than what the culture was when I was there. I'm sure as a big firm, it has to operate in certain ways. So now the question is, how do you differentiate your culture and how do you build a culture that will allow people to feel good about work? So I'm just going to ask Ian some questions as a way to sort of illustrate this. You graduated from a pretty good college. Tell us a little bit about what you studied and where you graduated and how you decided to kind of go into law.
So I graduated from the oft-overlooked Reed College, which is famous for such dropouts as Steve Jobs.
Very famous.
Yeah. It's in the suburbs of Portland. It's honestly, it's a very rigorous kind of academic-based liberal arts college, which kind of has a curriculum and set of, I guess, academic exercises that they have you go through, which puts you in the mindset of going to grad school, but in a way kind of situates you very nicely to prepare yourself to be a lawyer as well. Like, one of the big requirements is you need to complete a senior thesis before you graduate, which is a great exercise in argumentation. I'd studied history, which is basically, you know, a practice of making arguments about what happened, and as I went through my history, Bachelor of Arts, I realized more and more that I really enjoyed argumentation. My heroes have always kind of been, like, illustrious government figures. You know, I'm a big fan of people like Robert Mueller, I guess, is the big example right now.
That's the current one.
That's the current one, yeah. Right. And so I figured, like, if I enjoy argumentation and I admire these guys, like, I should try and be like them, you know, try and be a lawyer. And that's kind of what brought me to Computer Law Group, I guess, after
graduation. Tell us about the journey and how you got there, because you took a first job somewhere else, or a part-time job somewhere else, if I'm remembering right?
Yeah, I mean, over the summer I worked as an intern for a startup, which essentially what they were trying to do is they were trying to create a library of landlord-tenant law for the benefit of tenants. And this was supposed to be, like, on an app. So, you know, if you have some problem with the landlord, maybe they're taking too much time to replace a leaky faucet, or you've got, like, a mold problem, there's laws that govern all of this. You know, there's laws in California or in Oregon, which is where I was at the time, that says, look, if there's a leaky faucet and you file a request for them to repair it, they need to repair it within X amount of time. Otherwise, you can sue for X amount of dollars. So it would be good for a tenant who typically has less bargaining power than a landlord in this kind of context to be able to just look up those laws like that and be able to send off the right letter or the right email to the landlord.
So this is really apropos to this show, because this show tends to be about real estate and about real estate investment, management, development. So you are actually, your first exposure to law was in the field of real estate from a tenant's rights point of view, which is still helpful for landlords to understand, and packaging law in a self-service way.
That's true.
So the automation aspect was interesting. I remember when I first interviewed you, I thought, you're actually ahead of most other people in understanding how law of the future is getting packaged for consumers to make it more accessible. I mean, Google and many others, Find Law, Yahoo, a bunch of other sites for free provide those platforms. That continues to be a trend going forward. Obviously, whether individuals can actually use it effectively is an open question. And that's where lawyers and licensing the practice law comes in. But how did you decide then to eventually leave that company and go, or that firm, and come and interview with us?
Well, I mean, beyond the fact that I like getting paid for my work.
There you go. That's always a factor, right?
I mean, I was interviewing around for a lot of law firms. I mean, I talked to, there's like a healthy community of RERL alums who have gone on to be lawyers. And I talked to a few of them, and the number one message that I got from all of them was that if you want to go into law school, if you want to be a lawyer, first try out being a paralegal. Because, you know, a lot of people go into law school and they start law school and they're like, well, this isn't what I expected at all. But suddenly, you know, they've already committed to 3 years. And they said that there's no better experience you can get in understanding what litigation or just legal practice more generally is like than working as a paralegal, working for lawyers, doing the litigation work. So I knew I wanted that to be my next step. And I interviewed around at a bunch of different law firms. And, you know, I've always been, like, interested in IP law and technology law, but I honestly didn't expect this to be the place where I'd end up. I grew up here in Silicon Valley, but I was interviewing all over the country. And you don't know this, Jack, but I, right, like the week before I interviewed with you guys, I interviewed with a law firm at Seattle that does workers' comp. They ended up not giving me the job. But after you hired me, like right after, they came back and they were like, wait, no, we do have a job.
We need you badly. Change your mind.
But I'm glad I work for you and I'm doing interesting Silicon Valley stuff instead of sitting at a desk and filling out workers' comp stuff all day.
I think that's important. I think you've said three things that are really important. One is that, in my opinion as well, the old guild style that used to exist many decades ago, before law schools, centuries ago perhaps, before law schools even existed, people read law with a lawyer. So Lincoln, Abraham Lincoln, didn't go to law school. He clerked with some lawyer to understand how to build arguments, how to deal with the common law, that is the development of the case law, how to make points both procedurally and substantively. And that's how people learned. It was literally on-the-job training. And I like to say the best lawyers tend to be people who really got some exposure to law. Typically, it's through their family members or some extended friends or someone who says, hey, here's what it's like to practice in either the private practice of law, which is what we do, or public service law, which is what Bob Mueller does and all those, most of the people in Washington, D.C. do. And it's really a different style of practice, but the point is it's an exposure to the argumentation style and the reasoning process that lawyers go through. So that's your first point. I fully agree with it, and it's really about this guild nature that maybe law schools should say you get extra points for doing. I think they indirectly say that because you bring a lot of real-world experience into the law school. The second point is that you have to choose kind of where you want to get some exposure to a network. So if you really wanted to have a network in Oregon based on going to Reed, you would be interviewing lots of places in Oregon, and you would wait for an offer. If you wanted to have a network in Seattle, you would probably have taken that job in Seattle. But if you want to come back home and have a network in Silicon Valley, because I came out here from New York, and people said to me, and I passed the New York bar the first time, passed the California bar the first time, they said, you got to come back to New York because this is where people do, like, the most interesting law. And I took the view that, no, from what I could see, Silicon Valley was emerging as a major center of innovation. This is well before, you know, what we have today, some 40-odd years later. So you have to choose a location, and then once you choose a location, then ideally you try to find the right employer. And that gets to the third point, which is there is a huge difference between a small law firm and a big law firm. There's just no question about that, because bigger firms have hierarchies and smaller firms tend to be much flatter. So you operate in a much flatter team. You're going to get a lot more responsibility. Some people sometimes feel like it might be too much. You've been great in being able to say, no, you know, I can do it. Let me write the first draft of this argument. I look forward to doing it. Maybe that's from all the work you did on your thesis at Reed College, but tell us what your experience was like even in the first 6 months. Did you feel like you were overwhelmed, or did you feel like the challenge was right? I'm kind of curious how you felt about this culture that we have where we try to get people to extend their human potential beyond what they might imagine exists.
Yeah, there really isn't any way to sugarcoat it. Like, litigation, even at the paralegal level, is hard work. And I feel like a lot of people kind of expect, like, the legal profession to be like mock trial or speech and debate. It really isn't like that. There's a lot of paperwork that needs to be done. There's a lot of forms that need to be filled out. There's administrative work that you need to keep up on. Like, you got to calendar all of the deadlines, because if you don't know the deadlines, everything falls apart. You need to conform to the rules of civil procedure. There's all kinds of rules of court that you need to follow, like even down to the local level, where a single judge likes papers to be filed in a different way than another judge who operates in the courtroom next to them. And so this all takes up a lot of time.
Like, a lot of cycles.
Exactly, mm-hmm. A lot of cycles. Like, that's 70% of what being a paralegal, and to a certain extent what being an attorney is making sure that you conform to all of the rules.
But there's no automation yet. There's no one-button automation yet that just says, put in this draft document and please conform to all the rules. So far, we haven't seen that. It still requires people time to do that work.
Yeah,
right?
And it's so easy to miss things, which is just kind of like the worst feeling in the world is when you submit something and you realize as you're looking at the document that you submitted that there was like a little typo or just like something.
You always find it just 5 minutes after you've electronically filed, which is a big innovation. Years ago, way before your time, the filings were all done by messenger. To some degree, there are some courts this is still true in, but for the most part, all filings, particularly all federal filings, are now done online through a system called PACER, and literally you have a PACER account that attaches to each court that you're admitted to. So because I'm admitted in so many different federal district courts and federal courts of appeal, and of course the U.S. Supreme Court in the United States, there's pre-designated access to all those PACER sub-accounts into all those courthouses. But you have to know how to do those filings. Like, literally, you have to know what buttons to press to do that.
It's funny that you should bring that up, actually, because this morning we did a filing where the judge actually required that we go down to the court. Mm-hmm. But he also liked the filings and emails. So what we had to do was Venetia, my coworker, the other paralegal, she had to actually drive down to the court with all of the filings and hand them to the court clerk, while at the same time I sent an email to the judge. So he got the documents, like, both by email and in paper.
In a state court case, when the judge is under the gun, as I think I know the case you're referring to, this quote-unquote emergency ex parte type restraining order request, and those do happen, and they do happen with some regularity, even in business cases. Certainly they happen in domestic cases as well, in civil cases. The reality is some judges want to actually read paper, and they'll ask you, please deliver a courtesy copy in chambers. The actual filing gets done electronically, typically, by the electronic system, but on the whole, you're right. You do end up sometimes doing a paper shuffle where you have to print stuff out and make sure it's stapled correctly and has holes punched at the top and so on. There are rules that apply. So, you know, a big part of that exposure is if you don't like following rules, you probably shouldn't be a lawyer, or you certainly shouldn't go into litigation, because at some level you may be deciding, hey, against something that you really would be better doing something else at, like, you know, being an artist or a sculptor or someone else. But you've adapted to that and you embrace understanding it. So tell us how you feel about it.
I feel good. I mean, I gotta say, like, it definitely took adapting. Like, it's different from writing papers and, you know, like, responding to questions from professors. I think, like, a big part of the adaption was being able to work well under pressure, to kind of, like, feel more comfortable working under pressure. And the other big part is being, you know, able to collaborate very closely with people, because, you know, it's always a team exercise in law.
And the interesting part is most business clients, they understand that there's complexity, but they don't really know or want to know all these details, because their view is they're hiring you to deal with the details. It's a little bit like in Joe's business, in the real estate business, someone just wants to get a loan, or someone just wants to get a real estate transaction done, or someone just wants to get from point A to point B in a particular business deal. They don't want to know all the phone calls, all the emails, all the cycles that Joe went through. They would like to just know that the deal is done or is getting done. That's a lot of the way business clients look at things. And you, as the lawyer or the lawyer in training or the paralegal soon to go to law school, because typically people stay for a couple of years, some people even stay for 3. We've had a few stay for 4, and even 1 or 2 that stayed for 5, because they said, hey, I really want to get super good at this before I go to law school. And they were deciding what law schools they wanted to go into, and they decided, hey, I'll take my LSAT exam again. I want to get better scores. Usually the result is they become better and better at the practice of law, and law school almost becomes kind of a big yawn for what should only be arguably 2 years, as Obama once said, to now 3 years, or it's been 3 years for a while, but there's an argument, particularly if you do clerk at a firm for a couple of years, that maybe they should give credit for 6 months or a year. I remember when I was in law school, you could clerk your last half of your 3rd year for an appellate judge, which I did, for an appellate justice on the Court of Appeal, with the view of that's credit, because you're learning from that judge. So you're literally getting exposure to how appellate work works and how the process works and how arguments are made to a court of appeals. So that was quite an interesting exposure. You're getting it really early. Sometimes I like to say to people, does that sway you in any direction to stay away from certain areas? It sounds like you've decided you don't want to just fill out a bunch of forms, right? For sure, right?
Yeah.
What else have you learned?
Well, you learn that there's different... I guess what I'm trying to say is that you learn that law doesn't exist in a vacuum.
Mm-hmm.
Like, that's a really big lesson that I think I've taken away from working in a law firm that I wouldn't have gathered in law school. If you want to be a good lawyer, you need to do more than just, like, understand the laws and understand the case law and have, like, experience as to how a judge might rule or, like, what litigation is going to look like. You need to make an effort to, like, understand what the client's mindset is as well. You know, you need to understand what the client wants. You need to understand what the other side might want. In most contexts, that probably means a basic understanding of how different business processes work. So, I mean, I've learned a lot about things like mergers and acquisitions and bankruptcy and a bunch of random stuff that I didn't think I'd really ever have to know about. In Silicon Valley, that often means a basic understanding of different, like, scientific and technological processes as well. You know, I was really bad at math in high school. Like, I thought I was done with it. But in the past few months, I've found myself having to kind of, like, revisit statistics and even a little bit of calculus as I kind of look into things like machine learning and other concepts behind the technologies that are really driving innovation in the Valley right now and that our clients are kind of on the cutting edge of innovation of. So.
And you just hinted at a point, or you alluded to a point that's true for our firm, and I think it's true for the best law firms, accounting firms, professional service firms, management consulting firms, knowledge worker type firms, whatever they are, which is the goal is continuous learning. The goal is continuous improvement. The goal is sharing knowledge. The goal is building on knowledge of others and improving it over time. So whenever there's something that can be done better, that can be turned into a better checklist, that can be turned into a better template, that in the future could be turned into a better form of computational intelligence, and I'm using that term very broadly to denote or to connote the idea that in the future, much more help will be available through the computer systems that are readily in your pocket in a smartphone. So these rules and regulations that you were trying to package for tenants in Oregon, that becomes sort of a simple case, and this ability to say, okay, here's the case we have, we've done it before, but it has these nuances, how are we going to deal with the nuances to make sure the best advocacy occurs? All of that can be brought back to life so that the wealth of knowledge based on, now I'm about four decades into this, I don't have the four decades of electronic work product, because back when I started, lots of stuff was just typewritten, never stored. But in your day, when you get out of law school and you graduate and you pass the bar and you're practicing law, all of your knowledge that you replay to the world will be stored. So you will have, yeah, think about it, you will have your own Google databases that start perhaps with the writing that you're doing today, like the brief that you initially drafted yesterday and that was finalized by me and other attorneys at the firm and presented and filed today with, you know, hand delivery to the judge. Literally, that stuff's all in your historical file that you'll probably have on your phone. And literally, you'll be entitled to go back to. You'll have on your watch. And in your interview with whatever your next employer, assuming you don't come back and work for us, it'll be something along the lines of, and we do hire people to come back and we welcome them back, is you'll say, well, look, I've handled this. And they'll look at you like, but you just graduated from law school. And you'll say, yeah, but I did a couple of years before I went to law school. And that's the cultural thing I want to communicate about growing a culture within a firm that generates a replay of knowledge. And this is true at any good firm, any good company. People respect that culture and they want to participate in it and grow it. And why don't you give us some of your thoughts on that? Because we do try to have both formal and informal education in our firm, and it might be helpful to just talk about that for a minute.
Yeah, I guess, like, and this kind of circles back to some stuff I said right at the beginning of this interview. One of the great things about working at a small firm is the depth of, I guess, the range of tasks that you get. You know, I'm not just filling out forms. And it's great. It's often sometimes kind of intimidating to be trusted to do things like draft briefs, which is, you know, what Jack was just talking about that I did yesterday, because these are documents that are going to be submitted to the court and read by a judge in some cases, you know, a federal judge, sometimes an appellate panel. You know, these are very important people who make very important decisions, and the idea that they could be reading your arguments, they could be reading the arguments of some kid that just came out of a small liberal arts college.
Some well-educated kid that did well at a great college that Steve Jobs almost graduated from.
He only lasted like one semester. It's daunting, but it definitely, the act of getting you out of your comfort zone in order to do these kinds of tasks, which you might not initially believe yourself to be capable of, is educational in a way that very few other learning methods are educational. You know, it's trial by fire in the truest sense, but, you know, if you don't get burned, and there is a network of people that are helping make sure you don't get burned, because if you file something terrible with the court, you know, that's it. Like, if you don't get burned and you can kind of persevere through the challenges, then suddenly you know how to do something, or you're a lot better at being able to do something which is very, very important, which is a great skill that you're going to be using for the rest of your career if you go into law.
Right. You might surprise yourself. I mean, there's actually a lot of psychological studies, and this will be the final point that I'll make before we wrap up, which is at Computer Law Group, and really at every firm that I've previously worked at, and really every job, as I think about it, that I've ever had, this idea of pushing human potential beyond the comfort zone so that you're not in the area of boredom where you have a lot of skill and very little challenge, but instead you're on the edge of anxiety where you're doing stuff that you're pushing the skill level up rapidly, so you're moving from the green slopes to the blue slopes to the black slopes to eventually the double black diamond slopes. If you're a skier, it is winter time of year. As you learn how to ski, you learn how to move off the bunny slopes to the bigger and bigger slopes. That pressure of traversing the more difficult terrain builds more rapid skill. So when you do that, and particularly when you do it in real life, so it's not just some sort of, you know, hypothetical exercise with real clients that have real cases and real interests, and you get to meet the clients, so you're not just in the library, you're literally in the conference room around the table that are making some of the strategic decisions, you really learn a lot about, hey, this is critically important, I'm going to do the best that I can do and improve upon that over time. So when you come out of that kind of training, you build for yourself this goal of, if I'm bored, that means I'm not challenging myself. If I feel anxiety, that means I'm accelerating my learning. It may be difficult terrain, but by the time I'm done, I'm going to actually feel really good. Now, hopefully I won't break a hip or break a leg or an arm in the process, and lots of people do, although not in the practice of law, but in skiing. The goal is to kind of take advantage of this idea of moving yourself into your zone of discomfort, because that's going to build more and more skill to kind of get out from your comfort zone. So I'm glad you touched on that, because that's part of what I think is the culture you aim to have at a company as well, particularly startup companies. We represent lots of people at small startup companies. They're always in the zone of anxiety. They're always pushing themselves. They're always pushing the envelope. They're always hoping to develop the next great thing. And often there's going to be some failure, because that's part and parcel of pushing the envelope. You're going to fall on your skis. You're going to wear a helmet because you don't want to get hurt, but you're going to take some tumbles, and that's what you do. So let's just wrap up and talk about, like, along the range of experience, and it's just been 6 months, in general, what would you say were some of the more interesting things you've done, and how do you feel about those things, just generally speaking?
The most interesting stuff I've done has, I mean, I like I talked about earlier, I came into law wanting to do argumentation, and, you know, after I kind of, I guess, proved that I was good enough at filling out forms and, you know, drafting the most basic of legal stuff, I was allowed to do argumentation, which has been awesome. Like, that's the most interesting stuff I've done, has been drafting briefs, has been writing arguments, has been, like, feeling like I'm participating in the litigation process, which is, you know, there's really nothing like it. It's really kind of at the heart of what everyone imagines being a lawyer is like. And I guess the fact that it's only kind of maybe like 5% of what being a lawyer actually is makes it all of the more exciting. And so I'm excited to do more of that. I'm excited to do progressively more of that as kind of I get along with my career. And I'm excited to do more of that in fields of law, which I'm excited to participate in. And that's the second thing that I guess I'm looking forward to. One of the great things about working as a paralegal is it's allowed me to get exposure to different types of law. It's allowed me to see specializations that I'm interested in, specializations that I might want to take a pass on. I feel like that kind of firsthand experience is something you wouldn't get if you just go straight into law school. And so that's truly, I guess, unique and exciting that I have a better idea of what part of law I want to go into, what sections of law I feel are going to be the best for me personally as a career. And that is really, I guess, encouraging to know at this point.
Great. Thanks, Ian, for coming on. I'll just wrap up by saying the final point is, just as I said, knowing your customer, Joe and I discussed how you build on that. Knowing where your firm and company culture are and what's going to attract people to it, to build on it so that it creates a better and better firm over time, and adding people that are aligned with that culture really is an accelerant to delivering better and better services, better and better products for product companies. Of course, lawyers are service providers, although our products are actual knowledge products, writings, briefs, agreements, contracts, paperwork that lots of people don't really want to do. They want to delegate it to their lawyers. But conceptually, the firm has to have people like Ian and many others that we have who are passionate about what they're doing in the actual practice of law. So with that, we'll wrap up. I'm Jack Russo, the managing partner at Computer Law Group. We're in Palo Alto, California. My email address is jrusso, J-R-U-S-S-O, at computerlaw.com, 650-327-9800. Thanks, Ian, for coming. I appreciate your time. Thank you for joining the firm.
Thanks for inviting me.
And thank Joe for letting me use this segment to talk about knowing not only your culture, but knowing your employees and what makes them excited. Thank you.
You've been listening to Real Estate Radio Live. For more information on today's program, visit reradiolive.com. That's reradiolive.com. Subscribe to our podcast. Discover more at reradiolive.com.